Hello everyone, I'm Angela Chan and I am super excited to be chatting with Struggles for Sovereignty. And this is for Virtual Realities Festival for 2021. Thank you very much, Michael, for putting this event on. And so I think we'll begin by introducing ourselves. So members of Struggles for Sovereignty, would you like to go first? And then I'll introduce myself after.
Hi, I'm Alec Steadman. I'm one of the members of Struggles for Sovereignty. We're 10, so there's four of us here today. And I'm also part of a curatorial collective called Bodies of Power, Powerful Bodies.
Hi, my name is Sanne. I'm also part of Struggles for Sovereignty and together with Alec, part of Bodies of Power, Powerful Bodies. And we're calling actually at the moment from one of our hangout rooms, bedrooms in Jogja.
Hi, everyone. I'm Eliesta Handitya, or you can call me Lista, and also a part of Circle for Sovereignty, but also a part of Bakudapan Food Study Group, one of the the collective talking about the food and everything related to food, not only just the food, but also like the politics or the political economy or the behind it, like the problem behind it. Okay, and Bakudapan consists of 8 person actually, and one of them are Elia.
Okay, so my name is Elia, like Elisa mentioned, part of Bakudapan, also Struggle for Sovereignty, and also I'm a neighbor of Sana and Alec, so they are now in their house next to one block from my house. So we are now in a bit of like a lockdown in Indonesia since the pandemic is getting worse again in here. So we are working from home, online from home. Yeah, so it's really nice to have this chat online.
Yeah, definitely. I'll speak a bit later about how we met online as well during the pandemic, and that has been very special. I'm Angela Chan. I call myself a creative climate change communicator. That works as an umbrella for me to work as a curator, a researcher, and an artist. And I have a specific research interest in climate change, and specifically what it means to talk about race, class from a British diaspora perspective. And I work curatorially as Worm Art and Ecology. I use that name. And as an artist, I use my own name and have been recently doing research on the colonial British production of dynamites and now moving on to thinking about the water systems and different types of pollutions from these types of extractive industries and also conflict. So I am, as I said, very excited to be in conversation with you because I came to your reading group at the start of your activities last year, and I think it was like reading group number 2. And so it was quite early on and we watched a film, and it was just really great from my perspective to understand and have like discussions or take part in people having discussions about climate justice that are from different areas of the world. And I think this is something that generally within the climate movement globally and also within the arts is very important. We need to encourage a lot of these kinds of activities and be open to being across time zones and languages. So yes, this is why I really value this session, for us to basically get to know each other. We've called once before and I've taken part in your reading group before, but this is the real kind of juicy getting to know each other part. So the kind of outline of the this session is that we've got some of the talking points that we're really interested in. We find that they are where our practices overlap, but also we face similar challenges but have different maybe strategies or different contexts to kind of work through. So for us, it would be very meaningful to talk through these ideas and start to kind of share how our experiences working in sometimes quite interdisciplinary practices mean for us and the people that we also co-labor with. And I guess like the starting point that we all share is that a value we really want to push forward is that ecological justice struggles need to be intersectional. And so with that starting point, would you like to kind of express how you share this value and any projects that you want to kind of initiate the conversation with?
I think, so maybe we didn't do a very good job of introducing what Struggles for Sovereignty is yet. So maybe we can just say a bit more about what is Struggles for Sovereignty. And then I think maybe as part of that, we'll lead into talking about, how those values you spoke about build into our approach. So, I mean, we're essentially a curatorial platform, although, our members are made up from artists, researchers, like not only curators, but curatorial in the sense that we work with communities mainly across Indonesia, but also sometimes communities and practitioners outside of Indonesia in other global South contexts, who are in different ways, I mean, quite literally engaged in different kinds of struggles for sovereignty. I guess that's where the title also first came from. But like whether that's struggling for their land rights, struggling against different forms of extraction, whether palm oil, mining, dams, different forms of development. And the groups and communities we work with range from like adat communities, which is a kind of the word for Indigenous within Indonesia, but that's something we'll also talk about more later, the complexity of that, or kind of informal organizations or collectives or even individuals who are engaging in these kind of struggles for their land rights, their communities' rights, and for the kind of history of their knowledge and customs. And for us, all of those struggles are tied up in both kind of colonial histories and histories of imperialism and in terms of ecological justice struggles, even if that's not words that the people that we're working with would necessarily use to talk about their work. But so we work as a platform bringing together these groups to share their work with each other and sometimes with a public as well. But I think a key for us, a key driving factor is developing a solidarity network between those groups and communities.
Maybe that solidarity network could be like the key word for our work, like because we understand that ecological and social, like ecological issues are intersectional and interrelated, overlapping. So also if we only do it only like us as a collective of, or us in the art field, like it would not like finish everything. It would not like change everything. So that's why we want to use this platform to learn, also like learn to solidarity with other communities like across Indonesia, across the global South, people that who have like maybe similar experiences, even if it's completely different to strengthen our self, not to, give up or not to just objectify like the ecological issues like as a issue, like as a concern, but like really do it as our like practice and also in our everyday life and how it starts like by doing the solidarity, by connecting with another people. Maybe that's from me.
I think that both already pretty much answered the SF, what is SFS is, and then maybe later we can also come up with the other question related with their both explanations.
Yeah, I think that's a brilliant foundation for us to start thinking about all of these ideas. And it's the core of it being like a solidarity network is really important, because even when working within the cultural sector or as a cultural practitioner, disregarding the fact that you also need solidarities in that kind of workforce, the fact that you are resisting objectification through tokenization or resisting kind of poor labor contracts is a different type of solidarity. But then it also connects to the idea that you have to work in collectives to be adamantly individualistic in any kind of activity in whatever field is risky and dangerous, and it can promote poor values. And so I guess it kind of would be interesting for us to open up, like, how does the artistic or creative practices that we kind of all share come to fit with the ecological justice struggles, and how do you kind of like balance the intentions and maybe the challenges that come across as well? I can say that for me, it's always been something that I've been quite sure to be working on. I started researching and producing arts projects even when I was an undergraduate, and I started up doing worm art and ecology activities by making what started out as a blog, which became a website, which then became a curatorial platform. And so Worm Art and Ecology was an interview space where I would share different interviews with various cultural practitioners or activists or academics talking about climate issues within the arts from a creative perspective. And this built up my interest or my understanding of what climate change means in a kind of cultural narrative sense, in a more everyday understanding of it. How do we differently understand it and also consume this knowledge from the sciences, from the politics, from the news media, into something that is, you know, some people say that the arts is a more emotive or like a more sensory understanding of the social and climate justice issues around us. But the more I actually was trying to understand climate justice issues, the more I realized that the arts had its own barriers. I see kind of the arts and the climate movement from the UK perspective in a very similar difficulty, in the sense that they both have these parallels whereby certain demographics, certain groups of people can't access these, I guess, discussions or engagements. The arts itself has a very elitist beginning, and the climate movement in Europe, or like in the global north, is still driven by a business as usual sustainability approach that is green capitalism at the end of the day, that has stemmed from colonial exploitations and is now just an extension of like free market imperialism. But these are the things that I feel was lacking within the UK arts space that was talking about climate change. So how can we refocus discussions such as race and cultural identity in the UK when we're talking about climate issues? You know, places that are, you know, racialized people in the UK have different heritages which have been exploited historically by UK colonialism. So those are the dynamics that I think need to be paid attention to within this kind of specific standpoint that I'm on at the moment. And I wonder how, you know, certain barriers or kind of strategies within the arts and environmental justice overlap works for you?
Hi, maybe thank you for sharing about the, your experience with the UK art field. Wait, there is a seller of the boot go to my house. Yeah, okay, now, this is also something that for me, it's really interesting to bring up this conversation about, let's say, the climate crisis is happening in everywhere in the globe, but also they have their own struggle and their own language and their own gesture to talk about this, which is, for example, I found it quite different what the struggle in the people in Indonesia, for example, in the plantation or in the mining, with someone who also being activist in the Europe to talk about the climate crisis. So yeah, and then it's also I think interesting how in Indonesia, I think in many other countries in the global south as well, there is so many NGOs who come with this kind of a perspective of kind of, maybe you can say it's a green capitalism in their own mission to conservation, to protecting, and also to create some of a, you know, like a preservation of a nature or forest. But also this is it's implied really different how they enclosed with the community, like there is the access of the land, the access of their rights to living in their on land. It's really complicated. Also by the government, by the NGO, and by the own communities itself. So I think maybe Lisa and Alec also can adding our during our program, I had a learn a lot about the community's organization and arrangement, and then how their enemy is somehow it's really, you know, the enemy is not I think that for me the enemy is like the real the capitalism itself. So it can be your neighbor as well who wants to to change your land into palm oil plantation because it's supported by the government that you can have your income more stable. This is, for example. So working with this, maybe to answer your question, in our balance working with art, and I think it's they have like art is have their own possibilities as well to not be part of the kind of the NGOs or this kind of activist, you know, like this kind of activist who's also in the same lines with this green capitalism, but also and also art is they have also the possibilities of the imagination of how to build the movement or how to create kind of a struggle in many ways. Maybe this for me, I will add in, later if I know something more.
Yeah, I mean, like, maybe I just want to add a bit, like, we try to use like art, as Elia said, that it's maybe more freedom, more imagination. So to do anything, do things like with the community, like by using or maybe hijacking the infrastructure of art itself. So using like we can like with art, maybe maybe now we don't know what to do, but then like we discuss, we think about it, like what should we do, that is not always constructed by like that green capitalism institution, like maybe like what Elia Win said about it. And also maybe to amplifying the voices of the struggle of sovereignty, like in many level.
Yeah, maybe also just to add, like, I think it's also to do with the fact that maybe when you call something art, it somehow immediately exists within the domain of art or the art world, like whatever that might be or wherever that might be. Of course, there's not one art world, there's many kinds of art worlds, but at least it will end up in some kind of art world. And I think in the projects that we're doing, it's also about what kind of art practice do we engage with? Like we, for the program we're developing now, we're working with different artist partners who, as their practice, like work with communities, like always, so kind of building solidarity is part of their practice in itself. And maybe within the context of arts, that is called art, or that process or that building of relationships is called art, but for the communities, they don't care if it's art. And also in that case, the artists don't care if it's art. So I think where the kind of art practice sits can be mean different things in different places. And I think that's where it becomes interesting, because then I think you have the opportunity actually to have, not to have your fingers in many pies, as in saying like, I'm very cool or something, or like, I'm very much an opportunity, but like it's a possibility to apply for funding from the art sector, for instance, but then actually kind of use that in a way that is ethical also for the communities, for instance, that you're working with as a curatorial platform in this case, or as an artist, or so to kind of maybe also use, because in the end, like the art world also has its own language, and the fact that you speak that language, whether it's art speak or whether it's like funding reporting language, or like is a privilege and is a type of access that you can use. So maybe I think it's also like the usefulness of that practice in these different domains is important.
Yeah, that's a brilliant collection of points, really, and it really resonates with what I've been thinking about. And also the fact that within the arts, the language is very easily, a lot of activistic language becomes co-opted by institutional art spaces, whereby it's then fashionable to program events, exhibitions about climate change, to the extent that it removes a lot of the public engagement from what is actually possible. For example, where are the local networks of grassroots activists that you can then connect to? I guess I can respond to that. One of the challenges that I have as a cultural practitioner is the short-term commissions that the arts industry promotes. So you might get a commission to do an exhibition in another city that lasts maybe 2-3 months. So what kind of meaningful engagement can you really sustain there even after you've left? So it's, for me as a kind of independent practitioner, this is something that I've been thinking a lot about, and also struggling and also experimenting with different ways of trying to, I guess, outlive the legacy of what the arts funder can provide. And the project is only funded for 2 months, but that's not, I don't want the ideas or the enthusiasm or the excitement between communities, between the publics, between artists and activists to fizzle out, to kind of fade away when the exhibition closes. One example recently, before the pandemic, that curating an exhibition in the Netherlands, and invited local grassroots climate justice organizers to put together what we called a climate justice. It was like a climate visual cultures library, whereby there were different direct action materials such as leaflets, song lyrics, photos of different direct actions that had all happened in the Netherlands, led by Black, Indigenous and people of colour, who are also fighting for sovereignty. You know, the Dutch legacy of colonialism worldwide is something that has essentially brought them to the Netherlands as diaspora. And for them to continue their activism for sovereignty as well as climate justice, seeing them as both very interlinked, is something that you know, is my responsibility as an external practitioner to, you know, divert the public audience to. I feel that there's so much value in bringing people into an art space where the arts is funding this exhibition. So you can see artists, and there was also a science fiction author's work that was adapted as an audio piece. But what really anchored for me the project to the local environment and to the local, public engagement or headspace for these very global ideas was this library that, you know, hopefully can be something that's tourable, that can go to different, not only art spaces, but libraries and also info shops. And it can move beyond the Netherlands as well to different places worldwide. And I think bringing people into an art space comes with its accountability. Who is this work going to benefit at the end of the day? And who does it compromise? So if there's an arts project that is being made about climate change, about climate justice and also colonialism, there are grassroots activists who have been working on this right in the same city, who actually are not part of the mainstream Dutch, you know, climate justice discourse, because they are not part of this mainstream in the global north, which is very white supremacist and very problematic, and is headed by very pro-border anti-immigrant sentiments. So I think the language that, you know, you brought up about that the arts kind of promotes and then markets as its with its own agenda, with its own baggage of art speak, is something very problematic that we have to unlearn every day. And parts of, you know, what we kind of were discussing when we initially met to prepare for this session was the process, you know, of unlearning that you have been doing as well, and thinking specifically about how you label things is important. One thing that we spoke about was how do you label Indigenous? What are the problematic barriers of, especially from like a Eurocentric perspective, in the so just mean like a homogenous other, in the sense that it's not identifying that there are many types of Indigenous within one geography's Indigenous population. So how do you work through those, and how are you kind of communicating those nuances?
Maybe I can respond a bit to some of that and then pass over to someone else for some more. I think in terms of, thank you for that, first of all, because that was really, a really interesting kind of mapping of the trajectories and complexity of that overlapping between stemming from colonial histories and race into climate issues, and then the position of the art world within that, and ourselves as people occupying that field. And I think kind of connected to what you were saying, what we were discussing before about unlearning, we're also talking about how we, you know, recognizing our own positions of privilege and trying to repurpose those. And I think for us, particularly as, you know, we're white Europeans living in Indonesia, is really important to continually consider our own position here, our role within anything that we're working on, and those relative relationships. And I think we always only approach that in the sense of, you know, pushing ourselves to be repurposing whatever privilege we have. So whether that comes from network, visibility, access to funding, kind of something Sanne mentioned about before, towards the kind of communities, struggles and groups that we're working with. But it's a continual process of questioning. You know, it's not that there's a single kind of answer. And once we've done that, it's like, okay, sit, we're now no longer have a problematic position. It's a continual process of questioning in the micropolitics of everything we do, in terms of how we relate to each other, how we relate to the groups that we're working with, how then we relate to, let's say, external parties from the art world that might invite us as Struggles for Sovereignty to do something as well. So maybe I give one example, like a kind of slightly non-specific example, but we were working with a couple of museums recently around, you know, with a focus on decoloniality connected to land struggles. But both museums in white, majority white countries, like one a white occupied country, one a European country. Our role within that was to somehow represent an Indonesian position, which is, you know, is already a problematic role to be put in for anyone, for us as a collective, for any of our members, and, you know, us particularly, I think, as Europeans, would normally say no to that if it came to us individually. But within this collective, I guess our role is to think, like, together, all of us, to think about how we can make this platform useful for the groups and communities we're working with. Like, how can we, like, make sure that this isn't an extractive relationship. So whether that's in terms of presentation online, in exhibition form, in a collection, whatever the form might be, in depending on the collaboration, that it isn't simply extractive and presenting the groups and communities that we're working with to an audience elsewhere, but that somehow through that process, you literally feed back into the infrastructures and the work of those groups and communities. And I think the very first way you can do that is financially. Make sure that there's significant money going to those groups and communities, not only in terms of a small fee, but, like, in whatever ways you can to develop also, larger kind of contributions to their struggles. And of course, visibility, but visibility on their terms. I think that's also really important. Maybe over to someone else if anyone wants to.
I also think a lot. So during our work with SFS, it consists with the various power for bodies and bakudapan. But during the process, I also realized that this is how to look. I think Sanne and Alec show us a lot about dismantle the privilege, because I think previously we also didn't realize our privilege as a Java in Indonesian context. And to work, I mean, this platform is also for me as a way to reflection. Because in Indonesia, of course, this is very complex to say what is the adat, the tribe, the what you call it, pribumi, it means indigenous, and also it's really entitled with the colonial history by the Dutch, and then also how see the Java as a centralized as an, you know, in Indonesia. In the way of culture, economic, social, and so on. So when we are also being connected with other communities, for example, in Sulawesi, in Poso, or in Bengkulu, we are really like reflection what is for me, like, we had so many privileges as a Japanese, as a artist or people who's working in this kind of field as well. So, that's my reflection to think about it. Yeah, maybe before we just like taken for granted that, you know, there is a, I think Sanne and Alec before previously working in Germany as a curator in a white cube. Timothy at house is like a white cube institution in here in Java, in Indonesia. But then there is so many things that we are thinking about the privilege and try to including the elite of art field as well. So anyway, I'm still thinking about this. So maybe Lisa wants to go on first.
Okay, thank you, Elia. And maybe I'm thinking that in our process and discussion between us, between the artists or partners or also the communities, it's like a slight reflection, or maybe it's a big reflection for us or for me personally, not to like always try and always learn not to represent people, not to represent the communities that we work with. Like, how to redistribute, maybe Alexander and Elia talked about how to redistribute the privileges, but also like how not just only redistribute, but also thinking how not always, not to represent them, not represent everyone that we work with. This is also come from our conversation actually with like the communities and other communities, and they often ask us like what would you do with this platform, with the SFS. Like, it's kind of make us think too, like it's a process of thinking, it's a process of self-criticize ourselves, like criticize this platform. So yeah, it's nice to have like that kind of conversation, that kind of to always unlearn, also unlearn about our method. So yeah, so like our process is not, we think that it's not a fixed process of doing this solidarity platform, but like an ongoing platform, ongoing process, even until now.
I was just gonna add, like, I think it's a really, like, thank you also, Angela, for sharing. And I think, yeah, it's also actually, this conversation is a really nice time also for us to reflect, maybe also with Elle, with Lista, with Alec, like, because we're like often really working quite hard. So like to have time to reflect is actually really nice. But I think like what you were asking also or saying about how to not let something become, let's say when you talk about adat or when you talk about indigenous, like not generalize, or I guess also related to what Lisa was saying about representation. I think a lot of that, like the difficulty, and maybe more so because a lot of things are online now, or like in an exhibition space, like you mentioned, Angela, is that this publicness has a temporary feel to it, or like even in a conversation online, it's for instance, two hours because everybody's like attention span has already kind of ended. So whatever becomes public is of course only a fraction of what happens behind the scenes. And I think how to connect those two things is often quite complex or like interesting things to think about in terms of like the work we do behind the scenes in terms of working with the communities. There's so much communication happening actually that we can't, there's no time to share that in any way publicly. So I think that behind the scenes, something that is not public, like the reproductive labor of that, is actually often where the ethics sit. Of course, like anything that's made public has an ethics of its own because of the way or because who is hosting, like all kinds of privilege and in terms of power. But like that backend work, I think is where things are not general at all, because for different communities, we're talking to specific people within those communities. It's not just only is maybe an Indigenous group, but it's a particular person within a particular Indigenous community, and that person has a particular opinion. Like, so it's like actually within those micropolitics, I think that, yeah, then maybe the important stuff happens.
Yeah, and thank you for Angela, like bringing about like the problematic, like the problem that lies behind the homogenization of the term of Indigenous. Because yeah, we've been talking about it too, and it's still our question too, in our collective.
Yeah, I really thank you for those responses, and I think that there's to add on. I think there's a lot of value in also ensuring that some things don't go public. It's almost as if some things are safer, and also I guess like important to be kept within the communities and within our partnerships or within our collaborations, partly to avoid tokenization, but partly to allow for, I guess, the eternal process of learning to really happen without fear and without the anxiety that mistakes can't happen as well. I think it's also in a way to have a private space to also do your processes of unlearning is ways that you can actually have very sincere conversations with each other and call each other in rather than call each other out. And I think there's, yeah, it's generally something that is quite strengthening between people, I think. So yeah, there's value in that. And so, yeah, I think everyone's kind of mentioned a little bit about how online working has affected or has like grown into something different in terms of your communications with each other, like even locally or even globally. And there's something quite interesting that Michael from the Virtually Reality Festival has brought up for us to kind of respond to, in the sense that to think of something as a communication as virtual is aligning it with a kind of like a form of computing software to something that is digital in this sense, then becomes much more mappable and trackable. So how does it work for you in the sense that online working helps kind of like put the dots onto those maybe timelines, maybe imaginary maps, not necessarily geographical ones, but maybe maps that you have concepts to kind of pinpoint. I think for me, working digitally has always been something that I've done as an independent practitioner. Like the online space was how Wormart and Ecology began. It's where I kind of was able to communicate with different practitioners who are thoughtful about climate issues. And it's, I think, yeah, it's definitely kind of been different to curate projects or kind of like to make arts workshops online, because you do lack the personal and intimate spontaneous discussions. And I wonder how this kind of has changed your strategies of working over the past year and a half.
Actually, for SFS, for a struggle for sovereignty, like we are working online like since the first time we created this, because we actually initiated like in the month of pandemic, in the year of pandemic, like the 2020. And that's maybe not changing how we work, but it shaped how we work actually. Like maybe the, like there is so much something to reflect, to also to criticize, but also like having this opportunity to working online make us like have an opportunity to get in connect with the people that we really want to talk with across like the maybe Indonesia, like because like we want when even like some people that we work with, like we never met them actually in life, like, and now we try to like get in connect with them and also learn a lot with them. And also already have like several discussion, like several meetings, and their work were really like inspire us so much. Like maybe like adat activists or indigenous activists in Kalimantan, like in East Kalimantan, it's an island in Indonesia called like Mbak Yurni Sadaria. Yurni Sadaria is a like from indigenous community aliens in Indonesia, and also like one person from Poso, Sulawesi, like the central Sulawesi. It's also another island in Indonesia. We connect with Lian Gugali. He initiated the Institut Mosintuwu, like Mosintuwu Institute, that talk about women and also about the ecological, have a very strong root in ecological practices. And from like through this online platform, we like the connection between us happened. Even that we plan to go there, like we plan to go there after we have several online meeting, even never met before. And yeah, that's maybe like the the thing that really shaped us. And actually from the like actually this year we are about to make like the offline, like to reconnect with the people, with the communities, like by really meet them personally after we like, you know, in a year we just do the conversation online. But this pandemic, this global pandemic still hit us even maybe more bad than before. So we need to rethink how to still be in connect with them and how to do that. Like we still think about it too. It's a big reflection for us. How can a interaction or how can a connection happen or the solidarity happen without like without meeting offline or without meeting physically? But also like there is maybe we try also like to criticize also maybe not like not by our practice, but like we maybe like there is a movie like from the artist Riyar Rizaldi, like the Kasitarit, that talk like reflect a lot about the how technological is also actually the extractivist like act, like extractivist activity, like using the gadget with the metal inside, it's also like extracted from the tin mining, and also the electricity, it's also extracting like the power plant, something like that. Even like the power plant is something that is been like fight by some of the communities that we work with. So but it's come that that it's only the way we connect now. So how to use, how to utilize, but also always try to rethinking, always try to reflecting the process, and also always try to how to strategize. Like yeah, somehow it's very hard. Yeah, we cannot say it's easy to have a connection or have a, like to create the strong solidarity in this like in this intersectional problem of the ecological issue. But yeah, we try to discuss to do like to questioning our methods, and it's still going until now. Maybe that's from me.
I think that's really important, like what Lise shared, like to add on to that, because like the film that she mentioned, Kasitarit by Ria, like we've screened that maybe like 5 times now, in different, always online, but across any time we get invited to do an event, we screen that in there somewhere, like first in our reading group, in various external events, in classes that we've done.
There's a link on our website as well, if you...
Oh, good idea. Sorry, I didn't... Yeah. But I think it's a good... it's a good film because it particularly focuses on this island in Indonesia, Bunker Island, which is where something like 80% of the world's tin comes from. And Ria was there working and researching together with the indigenous communities from that island. So it's through that film, it like really reminds us that like literally the laptop that we're sitting at, the phone that we're holding is part of the extractivist logics that we're talking about on those devices and trying to counter. So it's like being aware of that implication in the even the technologies that we're using. And I think also maybe one other point that I thought of when Lise was sharing about the different communities, some of the groups that we're working with, like there's also a politics of access, like not necessarily many people that we work with really don't have good internet connections and they'll just be joining from their phone. And I mean, here it's a tropical climate. So if really heavy rain starts, even any of our connection who are sitting here now would start going, like the sound goes, like, so also when we're inviting groups that we're working with to join international events, it's like, we also have a responsibility to lay the ground about expectations. You know, people might fall off in the middle, and if they do, there's nothing to do about it, even if it's something been organized from 6 months before. And like, and also being aware that there's some people that might not have any access to Zoom, let's say. So being aware of that politics of access is important.
Maybe maybe if I can add something in terms of just like from a personal perspective, what I find hard sometimes is like, particularly in these like building of relationships, particularly at the start, no, what you're saying, like you have these spaces for private conversations, which are really important to have, like, and if you're already on Zoom a lot, you get tired much more easily, at least I do. So like, how do you build in space for these more private hangouts? Where it's the places often that you really build trust, and how do you care for people online? I found that there's almost like a different kind of language that I feel like I've had to develop, that everything that happens is on, like usually like you would offer somebody something to drink if they would come in, or you would, if somebody, if you feel they were not feeling well, you touch them, or like there's always some type of interaction when you have, like when you're in a physical space that you could use, but everything on Zoom, like, I mean, literally you only see our faces, no? There's nothing, like, you don't know the context, you don't know, like, anyway, there's like some sort of cut up, even though there's a possibility of bringing people together that otherwise you wouldn't, which is amazing. But this question of how do you care for people online, there's this language that I felt like I had to develop, in which everything that you would otherwise also use other kind of senses for, in a way, you almost have to articulate, which sometimes feels very strange. Like, so yeah, maybe that's just another, I just thought of that, but yeah.
It's true. And Angela, you've been like done a really good job of like showing how you can do that with this event, like in the working up to it, like your approach to it, I think really is a caring approach. Like,
that's really good to hear. And yeah, I completely second what you're saying about how do you actually communicate the intangible actions that we just generally do for each other. I think patience and wording has a huge impact because a lot can be misread between emails or Zoom calls. So that's a very significant thing. And Lista, just going back on what you were saying about technology, it's super important that we don't take for granted that nothing we use is actually neutral, and to kind of remember that in our kind of maybe expectations of how, I guess, flexible our next strategies can be. Like, can we depend on this type of technology, that type of technology, when when changes happen in the world, it still has a trail of non-neutrality. Access, which you've mentioned, is incredibly important. Understanding that it's still, it's, you know, the pandemic has definitely shown us all of the inequalities and inequities that we've always had, just a bit more clear. And yeah, I'm just kind of highlighting these really important points that you've all brought up. That's very valuable. And yeah, I think for me, it's kind of great to hear that, like myself with WORM and kind of later things, that you have just been shaped by the digital sphere. The digital space is something that your project has been born into. The activities and relationships is something that you've had to like navigate online and then think about the in-person space. And I really hope that you're able to do the in-person activities that you've programmed soon and the situation gets better. For me, I really miss holding workshops, especially for young people, because it's something that I've been doing for the past few years that has been really great. And one of the youth groups that I worked with, the whole program was online, and it was just very kind of I guess like unfortunate not to meet all of the teenagers in person, but then to hear about their school days and how difficult, you know, the situation has been for them at the start of the pandemic. And I think arts or creativity or imagination still has its kind of optimism in those kind of periods or in those activities. It's a slight escapism, even though Zoom calls are very tiring, little kind of structured weekly activities did bring that kind of relief, I think, I hope anyway. And so maybe that's the unspoken thing within the strategies, like being there for a group of young people, saying that we will be here every week, turn up if you'd like. And that's the intangible thing that maybe you can't put into words, but that's the patience or the letting someone be dependent on your presence. That, I don't know, maybe is a strategy in these times. And I think it might be quite good for us to say what we hope for in the next few months. I know that you hope for in-person interactions, as do I. Are there any things that are exciting for you?
Fellowship.
Please tell us more.
Just quickly first to share after that conversation, funnily enough, in Elia's internet connection is bad. So, because I guess the viewers will see the blank screen. That's why she's gone off screen. Continual issue. do you want to share about the fellowship? That's you.
Yeah.
Boss fellowship. One of the boss fellowships.
With Elia also. So the program that we're developing now in the next few months is called The World is Our Household, which has like different program strands. Like one is a podcast series that we'll be uploading to a new website that we made. I will write it here in a bit. I'm not sure if the recording will show this screen, but with 6 podcasts with different groups from different parts of Indonesia and across the world, we are also will be working on new like commissioned writing. What else? Podcasts. I always somehow lose track. You know, it's very clear.
Writing. Writing resort.
We've got a group. We're working with a group of artist partners.
Yeah.
So across the program, they're kind of like in a more open role, basically free to do whatever they want across the program with different groups and communities we're connecting with through the other platforms.
Yeah, and then the fellowship program, which we've just been this last week been selecting from over 40 applications. Which basically we're bringing together 12 practitioners from different parts of the world to join a platform like of like maybe 2 to 3 2-hour meetings a week, in which we basically learn together and from each other and kind of also develop the curriculum together with the focus on building translocal connections between basically practitioners from different fields, but all with a situated practice. So we actually haven't, like shared this anywhere. So like, this is the, how do you call it? Like the, anyway, I don't know the word. I have the word somewhere in my head, but it's not here. But yeah, so basically there is somebody from AMAN, from the Alliance of Indigenous Communities in Archipelago, who joins. There, a farmer who's joining. There is people from the art world. There's a curator who's joining. So there's like people from really different fields.
An artist from the UK.
Artist also from the UK is joining. Yeah, so it's a really exciting group, I think. And we're also really excited, actually. So we all divided into different teams within SFS. So Elia and I are part of the fellowship team, which has three other friends. But everybody is involved in everything. But yeah, so that's, we're going to actually start that next week, which will not be public, but the fellows will contribute also to the program that we're developing. In what way, we don't know yet, because that will be decided altogether or individually, because they kind of work. And to the forum, which is the last basically part of our, of this kind of program we're developing now, which will happen second week of September is the current plan, which is also like kind of building up. Maybe actually somebody else can talk about this.
Yeah, a kind of coming together of everything we've done, but also, I mean, it's also something that we've already made the decision not to do physically, like to that kind of reoccurring element. So, but in a way, I think we found a good way to manage that, in the sense of, yeah, we simply just divide the budgets by a number of communities that we would have, like the budget that we would have had for travel and food and accommodation, divide it for people to do their own local activity in their context with their community, and then just connect online to share about what we've done. But essentially, it means we can distribute the money that we've had to, yeah, to the groups that we're working with, which is great.
Mm-hmm.
That sounds really exciting. I wanted to say also that it's it must be really great to also have a small group of people where you can have discussions, and it's kind of maybe a peer group that whatever happens in the next, you know, few months of the pandemic, you still have a continuation of ideas, and you don't have the unknown of, oh, when can we meet new people next, when can we get new ideas, when can we get, you know, new things to unlearn and processes to work through next. And I think, you know, this grouping is very exciting, even as someone who's like hearing about it, like, yes, this sounds great. And I'm looking forward to, you know, how it all develops. I'll be following. Elia, Lisa, would you have anything to add?
No, I'm good. I'm just a little bit lost, but maybe I just wanna share our website. Website. That's all. Yes.
I went on our update recently. Yeah. So it's still on update. So soon we'll be a bit more maybe a bit from me, like I just hope that I cannot hope that the global pandemic is will over right now, just hoping that we can still support each other even if through online, make like as a kind of concern about the like the interaction that happened through online, like hope that by this kind of interaction we can still support each other, like making the interaction, like making like the online interaction become like a support group, not only like a meeting, not only like a one-sided discussion, like there is a panel speakers who talk about something or who talk about ecological things, but yeah, let everyone to express their minds, let everyone to express their, like what they are thinking, like, yeah, maybe something like that. And to create that, we will try to always rethink how to create a better safe space for people that we are working with. Like, yeah. Yeah, how to create safe space, maybe it's my keyword.
That's very important. And I want to kind of say to the listeners or kind of events audience that this website is great. I mean, it's got all of your past activities, your past online program of events. You've kind of summarized what you've done for each session of the discussion and reading group series. It has a portion of the world as our household activities as well, with writing, podcasts, community interviews that I see that you started very recently, which is super exciting. You'll put some more about the fellowship and artist partners and also your forum. There's this extracurricular part of it, the palmistry for plantations, which I had a read of, which is very insightful. And you just speak a bit more about yourselves as well. So I really encourage anyone who's, curious for learning more about SFS to really go on this website. There's so much information and I'm sure you'll keep on building it.
I actually wanted, because we shared what's coming up for us, but I was kind of hoping that maybe you could also share what's coming up for you if there's still enough time.
Yes, I forgot about that. And I guess what's coming up for me is that I've been working as an artist, researching the things that I haven't had chance to research so far in my, practice. With a lot of my curatorial work, it's amazing to work with other people and develop ideas together. But there are also kind of research concepts that I have had in my mind for years that I am finally being able to kind of spend time on. So at the moment I'm looking into how the UK's water scarcity is being talked about in the public, how the government talks about it, how the environmental agency presents it, but how everyday citizens and community organisers think about the water issues. So that's my current research project. The methodology is just a very fun collection of living room conversations, I'm calling them, videoed interviews that I have with other people, and seeing how water is actually very much part of our cultural heritages that we share, even within the UK. It's spread across so many different countries, practices all around the world. And then I'm also looking into how, continuing my research into water and conflict. So I'm looking at how protests and specifically tear gas pollutants are affecting water systems. So how do we link up climate protests, social injustice protests, with the extension of yet another environmental impact. A lot of people who protest initially, they're the ones who are the most disadvantaged by climate and social injustices. So what does it mean that the state's violence and state's sanction of weapons on the streets further kind of this cycle of pollutants and violence? So it's a lot to think about. It's quite a heavy subject, and kind of taking my time with trying to think about this more expansively, and just to kind of add on to the global movement of anti-arms.
Sounds really cool.
Yeah, really interesting.
So yeah, I'll look forward to sharing that with you, and I'll look forward to speaking with you very soon.
Yes.
And yeah, I'd like to kind of say thank you again for sharing this conversation. I feel like I've gotten to know you much better as well, and I'm just thankful that we have been able to kind of discuss our values and hear about what we've been up to as well, having met online and now talking online. Hopefully one day we'll meet in person as well.
Thank you so much, Angela, for hosting us in a very warm gesture, creating this safe space for us and also sharing together. Very nice.
Yeah, thank you so much. It's really wonderful. I guess it's actually hard, like particularly with the project, and actually thanks for listing all the elements. I forgot. I thought I should have opened the website. But
we always forget one thing. Whichever of our 10 members is speaking, they always get to like number 4 and then they're like,
But it kind of shows also in a way that we're also quite busy, but it's actually really lovely to have, like Lisa was saying, quite a warm space for reflection. So thank you so much for that.
Thank you for inviting us to have this conversation with some of our conversation have never been solved before in our internal even internal reflection. So yeah, it's more reflection time. I guess we are really quite let's say busy with all the programs we have, and then in the first I didn't realize this kind of curatorial program would be like this between administration, managerial. Of course there is a lot of our member working harder than me. But it's really nice to think about this again, and then not just taken for granted that we are a group, and then someone, for example, this morning I just had a meeting, but I was sick, but I just trust everyone who back up me with this job, but now I've been thinking about this as well, as a group.
Yeah, hopefully like there will some way to meet all with all of the whole group, because we are 10. Like groupies.
I actually think it's amazing that there's so many of you, because it must feel like a very cozy and just very supportive network within your Struggles for Sovereignty group as well. I hope that maybe in a year's time we can have this conversation again and see what's changed, what we've continued with, what the challenges or kind of solutions we've been having have been. Yeah, stay in touch.
Yeah, same for you. Thank you so much.
Take care. I'm wishing you all well.
Yeah. Thank you so much.
Bye.
Bye. Bye. Bye. Bye.